Here.
Carolyn? She's coming. Jeanette?
Here.
Barbara?
Here.
Patty?
Here.
Linda?
Here.
Here.
Okay, if you can just stand for the pledge of allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, I would like to ask if there are any members of the public that would like to have any comments about the budget appropriations public meeting. Okay, there is a limit of 5 minutes. If you could state your name, please.
Right, I'm Jerry Sapansky, 6851 Dobson and Niles. I hope we'll be able to speak at the general meeting also. The first thing, when I got to the website, I noticed there was a whole 5 minutes allotted to a budget. Now, seems to me if something is important in the budget, you allot more than 5 minutes. That's just in passing. In summary, what will be the increase in the budget, general terms in the budget, for this coming year as opposed to the last? Secondly, why was there not a budget in place for the new fiscal year? Voted on and acting, you're acting as I take it now without a budget. Is that correct?
We're acting without a budget?
Yeah, it says July 1st to June 30th of next year. What budget is in effect now? It is August. Okay, the next question I have, this isn't intended to be for the press. I hope you give us a fair hearing of what's been said tonight and publish it. So, okay. That first question was not answered. Secondly, what, if there is an increase, what effect will that have on the Niles Township library tax increment? How much will the average taxpayer in Niles tax be increased for the next year? Do you have an answer to that? Mr. Press, could you kindly note that again? There has been no response to that. So we're dealing without a budget. No one knows if it's, how it's going to affect the taxpayer. Okay. I'll make my comments at the next portion also, but I would really like to know why a discussion of a change in pensions was buried in a bylaw verbiage change on the website. No information seems to have been passed through the mails or on the village website. What you're trying to do is pass a new pension system, trying to hide what you're really trying to do by calling it a bylaw change. And I'd like to hear an explanation for that at the next session. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Is there any other member of the public that would like to comment?
Just a quick one. I'm Dave Carabota, resident of Niles, Illinois. Folks do a great job. The thing we have to really, really keep in mind is going back and forth all over the state and also locally is that the family budgets right now are extremely tight. People are having a lot of financial problems. So we're talking about changes in pension that is going to make the hair stand up on the back of anyone's head. We have, you know, family, as you know, running around 2, 3, 4 jobs, just trying to keep their real estate taxes paid. Number of properties locally around us that are in foreclosure, either because they cannot pay the mortgage or the real estate taxes every time. And my walking through Niles for several months from January through April, I had a lot of people tell me of the long-term plans to move from Illinois. And also the problems we're having without having a state budget, because change is just something that is really hard to do in Springfield. to be more fiscally responsible. And I'm just hoping and praying that our board here is going to be fiscally responsible when it's talking about pensions, okay? Because right now, there are a number of pensions in Illinois that are not 401K, they're trying to make them into more of 401K, that those pensions will not be paid, those benefits will not come, because if the property real estate taxes go off as high as they need to go to try to cover some of the stuff, people just won't be able to pay it. So if we can just keep that in mind, that we've got to dot the i's and cross the t's when you're considering what's best for the library and the library. Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to?
Yes, I would like to jump in on this pension business. You have a 401K plan now, why do you want to move to a pension plan? A pension plan at this point in time is going to be in, on the public. Right now, we have pension plans all over the state, all over our communities that are in deep, deep trouble. They are unfunded, and if we continue to do this, we may very well have another pension plan that is going to be unfunded in the future. Now, my name is Salvatore Sanzampano, okay? We always had a 401K. 401K worked for us for a long, long time, and I can't see why it would not work for you people. I agree with, what's your name again? Dave. I agree with Dave. You're a great bunch of guys and girls, and you do a great job. The library is phenomenal. I'm in here constantly, and you deserve everything you can get, but I don't see the benefit of a pension at this point, 401K, that, I think that's to your benefit rather than a pension plan. Somewhere down the line, somebody's going to have to pay for it, and if they can't pay for it, it's going to go down the tubes, and you're going to be out, like many other people in the state are going to be very shortly.
Thank you. Is there anyone else?
My name is Bob Zalesny. I live at 8460 Chester, and I too am against anyone changing their retirement plan over here, going to a pension plan. It's a proven, you see what's happening in the state of Illinois, city of Chicago's teacher pension. When I hear that the Niles Police Department is the number one underfunded pension in the state of Illinois, I sure don't want to see you people piling on top of it, starting off with something like this. You were elected to be trustees. You're supposed to be fiscally responsible for the people of, the citizens of Niles, and that's what I expect out of you people. Not going over here writing checks and spending money and like having a good old time. I'm totally against it, and I hope you guys reconsider or go outside and do some reading about pensions and where we are in the state and in this country. It doesn't work, it doesn't work.
I'd like to add one more question. What is the object of reverting from a 401 to a pension? What benefit is going to bring to you, and what benefit is it going to bring to the library and the village of Niles? Because the residents of Niles are all involved in this. They may not all be here, but they are all involved in this. We're all going to wind up paying for it, and in the long run, you may be able to be paying for it yourselves.
Thank you.
So what is the object of reverting?
Thank you.
From a 401 to a pension plan?
Anyone else?
Can anybody answer that question?
So my name is Mona Zalesny. I'm at 8460 North Chester also, and you've kind of taken away a little bit of my thunder, but I do really question, what is the true purpose of you changing this? I want to know the answer to that. Also, why are we going backwards? Corporations now are getting rid of the pensions and going to the 401Ks and the 403Bs because it simply isn't working anymore. Have you looked at Detroit lately? Have you been listening to the news? I hope you have, because we are a laughingstock in Illinois. We are the biggest joke, and I can't stand living there. I don't want Niles to be the number one joke here by just, let's just keep piling money on it. I can't handle it anymore. I don't want to pay anybody else. And my question for you is, I am not totally knowledgeable about this because there's no information about it. Would this be the type of pension where somebody would work 20 years or 30 years, and then we pay them for the next 50 years to do nothing? because that's the type of pension you're looking for. That is a huge issue. My pension and my private corporations, you get back the money you put in. We have matching funds, there are other ways to deal with this, but for me to sit, I'm getting red, because I don't want to sit there and pay people not to work anymore or to go find second jobs. And that's it. Thank you.
The other thing too, I'd like to.
No, I'm sorry. You've got your turn.
You can use my time. If I still have 5 minutes, you're welcome to it.
Well, what I wanted to say is that most of the people in Niles are average working people. What's the average working salary of the working people in Niles? 70, 80,000, maybe 80 at the most, maybe a little bit more. I don't know what your people are earning. I don't really care. I don't know what your pension is, but are we going to pay you more in your pension than I'm earning as a worker? And that's what's happening in a lot of these things. In your school systems, your teachers, your firemen, your policemen, I'm making $100,000 a year, and I'm paying for somebody who's earning $150,000, and then he's going to go on pension, and he's going to get 3/4 of that. And I'm still paying for that.
And he's going to have a second job after that. It's going to go.
Well, that's good. Okay, I get my say.
Thank you.
Just a quick question.
Did you want to say something?
Just quick. I started out a little fast, I understand. First, I want to thank you, and I do enjoy the Niles Library. Came on strong on this issue because if you don't have the answer, I'm from an accounting IT background, okay? If you're creating a budget and you don't know how it's going to affect the taxpayer, their tax bill, how it's going to increase it, if you don't know that, you better take a hard look at it, because that's what we're looking at. Not what your total budget is. We want to know how it's going to affect us. If it's $9.34 on my tax bill for your pension now, and it's going to go up to $50, I want to know that. And I think before you do the budget, you guys should know that. You should have those answers like this, and you don't.
And
so please vote.
Pay for your pension.
Right. So please vote this down, whatever you do. You got a lot of people that will, it'll cause an uprising. I'm going to guarantee all the people will say the same thing. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
I just wanted to make known that we don't have to reply to public comments really in our policy that we don't.
And
so I'm just saying.
You can't answer a question. Just, why is that not in the policy?
I'm just saying that's what our policy is.
And that's okay, but next time just say get it.
Okay,
then you don't
look all okay.
I'm sorry.
Can I make one?
Well,
Mr.
I just want to say, I just want to say
one more thing.
Yeah, I just want to say one more thing also. We have not even discussed pension, and what we did say about it, when we are going to talk about any type of pension, it's going to be a committee of a whole. So anyone is welcome to come at any time and be here with us when we make those decisions. We have not discussed pension at all. If you want to look back at any of our videotapes, pension has not come up. So
exactly. It hasn't.
But we have not been even making those decisions. We're not even discussing them.
It's in your bylaw change and ordinance in your
So that's all.
It's on your website as part of the agenda, a bylaw change. And if you go to the bylaw change, it's about pension change. That's hiding it in my mind, I think everybody else's. Why don't you come out publicly and see what the Niles voters say? I'm sure you don't want to.
I'm
sure
against the bylaw change.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Does anybody else have anything else that they would like to add?
I'm concerned that there was a letter in the Bugle that I think was somewhat alarmist as to what we're going to do tonight. We're not considering adopting IMRF or any other kind of pension. We're addressing a bylaws change that was made in March, and we're considering undoing the bylaws change that was due in March. We are not adopting IMRF or any other type of pension seeking. It's not on our agenda. We can't consider it. It's not something that we're going to discuss. I know there was a letter in the Bugle that led you to believe that And I'm sorry if people came here tonight thinking that that was going to happen, because that's not something that we're even able to talk about tonight. Adopting IMRF is not an option for us tonight. We cannot talk about it. It's not on our agenda.
Can I? Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Can I ask you if that subject does arise, it will be publicized as such?
Yes.
And not a bylaw change?
Yes.
Definitely.
And it will be in multiple meetings. We will promise you that.
You can't do it.
Because according to the information on the website now, because some of us do due diligence, it made comments that after three meetings, if you discuss this IMRF at three meetings, the third meeting will be a vote to either implement it. That's what, that's what the information.
Bylaw change.
Bylaw change.
Change to the bylaw.
And the way I, understood it.
You're understanding it wrong. It's only a change to the bylaw.
And is the IMRF in the bylaw?
It's the wording about that issue is about the pensions, but we are not proposing to change.
Must it be in the bylaw?
That's.
It was originally in the bylaw. We're putting the bylaws back.
Oh, that's why we're discussing.
So you see the difficulty now?
Yes.
Do you see the difficulty?
Right.
Okay, we're gotta be isolated, clear.
It is.
Okay.
Our public comment really needs to be done. I think everyone has spoken, and I think we need to move on with our meeting.
Okay, this is on this. I heard that they have somebody over here doing the study or looking at the library saying that we do not spend as much as, say, the Skokie Library or the Park Ridge Library, Glenview Library. We need to spend more. That we do not spend as much.
That was quoted by Ms. Lemke in the Bugle.
What?
It was quoted by
Susan.
You see, the author was Tracy Gruen of the Bugle.
Don't believe it. Maybe they're programming.
It was in print.
Is it possible maybe to say that we need to spend more in programming?
I didn't use it.
I'm just saying, because that could possibly.
It does not affect.
Anyway, this really appears, that's fine.
And we have the pressure. I want to find out. I quoted it directly. You said.
But the 5 minutes is up, sir. So if you want to take it, thank you. I mean, you could have taken everything and put it in your 5 minutes if you wanted. Susan, you can address that if you'd like.
I'm not sure what the quote is, honestly. A consultant recently informed the library that its expenses for materials, those are the books, the DVDs, the things that we buy, and databases are less than comparable libraries. As a result, spending in those areas may increase, and the library could hire additional staff members.
Continue.
Lemke said she also hopes to fill the assistant director position in the near future. Correct. Which I did.
You folks are doing such a great job for us. It's commendable.
And we have been trying, and actually taxes have gone down. So we have been trying, and we are very fiscally responsible.
This, believe it or not, the trust we got this with was not an attack on Mrs. Lemke. I wanted to find out for myself. That's a Bugle issue, then, if this was quoted. This sounds to me, the way it was written, like a consultant comes in and says, Skokie is spending $100, Niles is spending $75. Mrs. Lemke comes in and says, oh, I think we're going to have to add the 25 to get to the 100. That's how it reads if you read the whole article.
We need to hire somebody more, or we need to get all the materials.
No. So I think.
Right, thank you very
you
much.
You see, when you're coming from that approach, you guys.
That's not the approach we
took. Okay. Sounds like spending to me. Okay.
Thank you very much. I appreciate everyone's comments. Thank you. Are there any board comments on the budget? Sorry, that's the timer. I had a 10 minute on by accident. Is there any discussion about the budget appropriations for the fiscal for the 2015-16? Any discussion?
Oh, can I just ask our attorney to
sure.
just board meeting, and the public safe, just refresh our memory as to what the timing is required in terms of passing for school districts. What does state law require in terms of, I'm sorry, library districts, in terms of when it may be passed? Is it necessary that we pass it before the beginning of fiscal year, or?
No, it's actually the state statute on when you pass the budget appropriation ordinance is after the end of the fiscal year of a library district.
Thank you.
So we're in compliance with state law, is that correct?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, thank you.
Okay, any further discussion? A motion to adjourn the public hearing?
So.
Okay, Jeanette and Karen. Okay, if you could take a vote.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Do we want to take a 2-minute break, or do we want to go right into? Okay, perfect. If we can call the order, the NIOSH Public Library District Regular Board Meeting Agenda, August 19th, it is 7:17 p.m. Thank you, Joel.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, first we approve the minutes of the regular board meeting on July 15, 2015.
So moved.
Patty?
No, not me.
Karen?
Oh.
Karen? Did I take the wrong? Okay. Just the wrong one?
No, I just wrote it.
Oh, okay, okay, sorry. Okay, I'm sorry, so Patty and?
No, it was not.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It was Karen?
Mm-hmm.
And who's second?
All right, so, so we already approved the minutes of the regular board meeting of July 15th, 2015. Now I'm kind of confused where I'm at.
Second one.
Okay, approve the payment.
Consent, you're doing all.
Oh, okay, oh, I understand, okay, thank you, I was kind of, so, well, we'll just do them separately now. Approve the payment of the bills for operating expenses of. Oh, sorry, can we have a roll call for the approval of the minutes of the regular board meeting of July 15th, 2015?
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yeah.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so move to approve the payment of the bills of operating expenses of $228,818.82. Payroll expenses of $262,776.07, and special reserve expenses of zero for a total monthly expense of $491,594.89.
So moved. Second.
Jeanette and Karen? Let's take a roll. Oh, take a discussion, anybody have a discussion? Okay, take a roll.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Chair?
Yes.
Okay, any public comment? Do we have any public comments?
Not bad this time.
It's okay.
Do you folks know how many people use the NIOSH District Library from out of district? Do you have any idea of that count?
I do have that statistic, I don't have it in my fingertips.
Oh, okay. The reason I'm asking that, yep, people, I guess we all, we're all for kids, I think we all like people using the library. I think NIOSH is a really terrific library, really good. Should we, as citizens, say, for the trustees and the operations people, charge people from out of district for using Niles Library. In other words, can someone who happens to go to school here use out of district, come to this library and use it sort of as babysitting service, kind of a watchdog service? Does that issue ever come up to you? In other words, I drop off my kid after school here, and now it's kind of in the library area, and I'm getting free, whatever you want to call it, after-school care, daycare, whatever you want to call it. Does that issue ever arise before the board?
No, we don't have to comment, sir.
Oh, you don't have to comment?
Wow.
Learn a lot.
I would be happy to talk about that with you.
Afterwards? Okay, okay. The only reason I bring that up, as you can tell, we're anti-spenders here, and we like the way things are running with a nice tight-knit budget, okay? Will the libraries in our state turn into food service programs? Is that next? Are we going to branch out around Gulf Road for some convenience for some people? Okay, are those the issues that are going to be before this board? I think you've got to be mighty careful on how you expand and add additional branches for convenience. Because once that starts, everybody says, well, how come I don't have a hockey arena near my house? Okay, all those kinds of issues, why not me? So I'd ask you to please, if you could, get me that answer. I'm very concerned about it, because I think there are fees that can be earned for Niles for people who live out of the district and are not being taxed. I think it's fair. What that entails process-wise is, I don't think we want to get to the point like at the airport with the TSA where you're checking library cards coming in. But I think it should be discussed in the future. And that's just my comment. Thank you very much again.
Thank you. Any other public comments? This is Jenna.
Oh, I just can't believe that one. Just real quick, and obviously you're not going to answer me, but what is the effect of ebooks now on the libraries? And I just know from looking online and ordering books for my daughter, a lot of things are much less expensive on ebooks. So does that affect anything with maybe lowering the budget or looking at things like that? What percentage of people have moved over to ebooks versus the books actually in the library? So to me, I should see my taxes go down even more is what I'm thinking, if these are such a good bargain, but just a thought.
Anyone else? All right, treasurer's report.
Okay, so 1 month into the fiscal year and comparing our results against essentially 1/12 of the proposed budget, we have a revenue shortfall of about 43% or $588,000, and this is due primarily to the rate of real estate tax collections that we get from the county. We expect that to catch back up in the following months. Salaries for the month are $11,000 under budget estimates, or about 4.4%. Library materials for the month is $25,000 over budget, or about 41%. And this is due to early renewals of some of the library data database product offerings. Library operating expenses is $8,300 under budget, or 28%. This is due primarily to late billing of CCS charges for the month. General administrative expenses is $10,000 under budget, or about 40%, due primarily to slow spending in the legal and consultant line items. Employee fringe benefits are running about $1,000 under budget, or about 2%. Utilities is within $1,000 of budget expense, so just about even. And for the month, the net surplus is $262,000, which is $500,000 under what we expected for the budget, which was $770,000 And this is, again, being driven by the slower collection of property taxes, which had a $588,000 impact. And that's it, unless there's any questions.
I did have one question on here, and I should have asked you prior, however. There was one that showed that we were really high, like at 89%, is one line. If I remember correctly off the top of my head, over here, 83%. The public conforming rights.
Yeah, that's a single license.
Prepaid.
Yeah, that's a single license fee that we pay for the year.
Well, it's our movie licensing fee.
Oh, okay. I figured it was something like a database that we paid prior, but I just, you know, I wasn't familiar with that public performing rights.
There are a number, just in that same vein, there are a number of items which are approximately 100% expended. So like for our liability insurance, which is, as you know, with insurance policies, you pay that 1 year, 12 months in advance, basically. Also, the insurance on the library van, workers' comp insurance, those types of things are all 100% expended at this point.
Thank you. Anyone else have any questions? Director's report?
I had a few things that I wanted to give the trustees updates on that we've talked about before. The previous board was kind of interested in the plan that the Algonquin Library had implemented of not having fines any longer and seeing how that affected their return of their materials and circulation. And I just wanted to let you know that Algonquin at this point is very happy with the move that they have made. They feel like their patrons love it. And they're keeping their, they have not had a problem with materials not being returned. So they are happy with it because they feel like there's so much confusion and kind of bad feelings surrounding people paying fines. Yeah, but in fact, the new superintendent at Culver was saying, oh, he doesn't ever use libraries because he's always afraid his materials will be late. So, you know, in this day and age, you can do things online. So,
super.
But I thought that was nice. Anyway, I just wanted to let you know that two more libraries have now gone with that. The Elon Library in Lake Zurich, which is a CCS library, and the Vernon Area Library, which is the first non-CCS library. And so you may just start hearing some pressure from patrons that other libraries are not charging fines. But it's still, you know, it's pretty great experimental, and I would not advocate for doing that. We are, you know, we do earn a good $50,000 a year on library fines. And it is how part of how we get our materials back is people feeling that they, you know, they don't want to pay a fine.
Which you think like sort of generates a lot more revenue?
I think they probably have deeper pockets to be, I think all three of those probably have deeper pockets to start with.
Do they continue to remind people to return?
Oh, definitely. And the other downside of that is they send people to collection much faster.
Oh, so, that's right.
Because that's what I was just going to say. So how do they hold people accountable?
That's how they do it.
So if they hold people accountable by putting them on their, credit report, that's...
To me, I think that could cause more problems than collecting a fine. Sending somebody to collect.
Kind of what the police department does, right? As soon as you don't pay your ticket, you go to touch.
But I'm not advocating
but that's interesting.
The previous board president had been very interested in that.
And so actually, those are two pretty large libraries. So
yes.
That's why.
And then they're not handling money, I guess, was one of the other things that I didn't know. Anyway, that's just an update for you on that.
Thank you. I appreciate
they both just came up this month, so I thought you'd like to know. Tim had brought up last month that somebody, a patron, had approached him about our not having closed caption movies anymore. And we did look into that further, and now they have put some more of those back on the schedule now that we have upgraded our equipment, and we think that it will work better this time around. So I want to let you know that. Danette had asked about credit cards with points, since we have a Visa, and we do buy some things online, that it would be better to have credit cards with points, and she very kindly asked around for some possibilities. And so we are pursuing that. We're going to be soliciting offers from banks to find out what is the best offer that we can get. So thank you for that tip. That was a good idea. And then I wondered if Carolyn, if you wanted to tell them about this justice table that you sat at. I know it's not really part of my director's report, but I thought the board might be interested to know what you did on behalf of the library.
Well, it was actually the Village of Niles who attended, and I went along with one of their community relations representatives. And what I did as a representative for the library was indicated all the programs that we offer. The purpose was actually fair housing, and that everyone, and equitable opportunities for everyone. That was the purpose of the justice project or this event. So what I ended up bringing from the library was, one was the lunch program that we have, and the other was the different programs that we offer. I think there were some programs, they were from your director's report, actually. And it listed, I think, was it low vision? We offer something for people in that category. And we also offered some sort of youth, was it youth volunteers program that you had? And that the outcome was incredible and how many people were involved. In other words, during the summer, we offer this for the kids when they're out of school. There were several other libraries there. We actually had a pretty good display at the last minute, that thanks to Greg, that we pulled it off. And the Evanston Library came up to us, and she was diligently checking everything. She said she just wanted to make sure that we measured up. Just go right ahead, help yourself. We did meet a lot of people from the area. It was, the location was out in far. They do things in their community, things like they have a sharing, the township has some sort of sharing garden, and everyone participates, and kids learn how to grow food, but then it goes to the low-income families. So, I mean, we learned a lot of that, but I think they were impressed with us because we have a lot to offer. I brought all of our printouts and brochures. I'm sorry, I'm not prepared, or I would have been more detailed, but we looked really good. We stood out because we have so much to offer here. But that's what it was about.
Thanks. I just thought people would like to know that you had done that.
Yeah. Can I just start a quick clarification?
Certainly.
You mentioned the lunches here at
yes.
the Niles Library.
Right.
And I said, no, I'm sorry, it's to the library.
Oh, absolutely.
It's
right.
For that and we don't pay a dime for that. It's
right.
federal money that pays for that.
Absolutely.
Right. Okay,
right.
Thank you. Yeah.
Then I just wanted to call your attention to the patron comments, where there were a lot of them this month, and I'm not going to pull out any particular one, but I just wanted to remind you that that is part of your board packet every month, and if there's ever anything here that you as a board want to follow up on, please let me know and I can put it on the agenda. There was one suggestion here where somebody had said, would it be feasible to alert patrons when their library card expires? And I checked with our head of patron services, Athena, and it turns out there was. And so we could turn that on immediately. So that was great. Patrons make suggestions like that. And then the other thing I wanted to just mention is that we have dropped one of our databases, which is called tutor.com, and are substituting something else called BrainFuse. Starting this fall, and so that is a tutoring program that goes up through college, and then it has a whole part that is also working with career development and job seekers for on an adult end, and they you can submit writing samples and they help you work on your writing, and it was a very extensive array of services, and we have unlimited sessions on it for now, and so we will see how that works out for us. I just wanted you to be alert that that will be going up on our website within the next couple of weeks.
Do you have any questions?
Pardon me?
It is up.
Okay, thank you. Anybody have any questions for me?
I don't have any questions. I just wanted to comment on the Management Association of Boot Camp.
Yes.
That sounds great.
Yeah.
The Boot Camp, it says that they will be hosting it for September 21st, 22nd, and 24th. Where the supervisors will receive training on newest legal requirements for dealing with personnel, followed by going through processes of hiring, training, coaching new employees. It's really important. I think that's just a great 3-day event that you're hosting for the employees. And there was something else in here, and I didn't mark it, that you wanted to have the board members possibly attend. Is there something in here? thought there was, oh wait, is this it? It was today's demonstration, 19th and 20th, September 19th and 20th? The new spaces in Hollywood.
Oh, okay. I should hear that.
Sorry.
Thank you, shout out for that.
There were a couple things I knew that I wanted to mention.
Yeah, that's the opening of our new Makerspace, the Digital Media Lab and the Makerspace, which is collectively called Creative Studio, and then Studio A and Studio B, and then our new children's STEM lab. So those are opening the weekend at the 19th and 20th.
Because I know I didn't have my phone on me, and I wanted to put it in there, and I was like, I don't have my calendar.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to pop it in there really quick, if you don't mind, one second.
Lots of hands-on activities and just demonstrating the different possibilities for people. And then you have a couple things coming up on the agenda that will be related to that.
Just one question, what are the hours of this grand opening? All day?
No, it's, I think it's like 11 o'clock to 3 o'clock.
Oh, is it?
On the Sunday is obviously in the afternoon.
Yeah, it's 11 to 4 on, I believe it's 11 to 4 on Saturday, and 1 to 3, I think that's on Sunday.
Okay, great, thank you.
I don't get any of the questions.
Oh, that's good, just one moment.
It's okay.
I actually meant to bring the training, but hold on.
Okay, so at least that's in there. Anything else? Okay, all right, communications?
Just got one letter from Representative Nico, who's very grateful for being able to talk to constituents here at the library. We've been saying yes to any of the elected officials that have come to come into the library, as long as they're one of us. Things like the satellite office.
That's nice. Okay, committee reports, building and grounds of technology, we haven't really done anything with the committees yet, so hopefully there's any reports yet. Liaison reports, anything with the friends in the library? They have a meeting.
In the summer, they don't.
Okay, all right.
Hopefully September, they're in the next meeting.
I believe so.
September and, you know.
You know what, Jane? It's on the calendar.
Oh, it is, oh, I have one calendar, okay, I got it, okay, no problem, thank you. Legislative? And rails?
Nothing, except that they have been very helpful in dealing with the recent Freedom of Information Act request.
Can I go back to the committee reports? We were going to have a discussion on technology committee, just a general discussion, is that? Like a subcommittee discussion, or how do we approach it?
When we want to call for a committee, then we would just make a date, and then we would meet at a sub, at a other specific time to do a technology committee meeting. And so then we'll go to the new business. So move the library board of trustees, approve the minutes of the regular board meeting, oh, we already did that, I'm sorry. Move the library board of trustees, wrong one. Adopt ordinance 15-05, an ordinance providing for the budget and appropriations of the Niles Public Library District for County Illinois for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015, and ending June 30th, 2016. B, move the library board of trustees, approve the regular. Oh, sorry, okay. See, now the other one.
I'd like to move that we adopt ordinance 15-05.
I'll second it.
Okay, Karen. Okay, then any discussion?
I would like to suggest that we amend the budget to increase the staff line by enough to get enough staffing to really cover the new digital services department, and we had put, left the staff line at a kind of bare bones level, and I'm hearing a lot of feedback from my supervisors that they're very, very concerned that they're not going to be able to get it. And it's partly because we've had a kind of rash of illnesses and deaths in families, and it's really putting pressure, and they're realizing, you know, when we're fully staffed, it's fine, but when things happen, you start to really run into problems, and we don't want to open new spaces and then say, oh, we've got this new stuff, but sorry, we can't help you with it.
Page is there.
It was part of the budget, so part of the salary line. And it would be something where you would amend the budget at this time if you chose to do that.
Could we discuss benefits as a committee, employee salaries and benefits first before we just increase the line item? We haven't reviewed any of the salaries or where we stand with openings and who is actually in what position since we've had several changes.
And if I can just add to that, I always thought that we can always set the budget, but as long as we don't go over the appropriation, that we're okay.
We could do it that way, but I guess I'm a little uncomfortable doing it that way just because then it looks like I'm overspending and I don't.
Your appropriation is 80% more than the budget.
Right.
Quite a bit of money, so I think something we should discuss that.
I have a question, Patty. How much are you talking?
Well, we were calculating $150,000.
Okay, what are we at now that you're adding that to?
Is you're talking about the supervisor's line?
No, the salary line altogether.
The whole, so you're just talking about.
The budget, for total salaries is $3.1 million.
Right.
But what line item is going to be increased?
So you're talking just adding a little bit on each?
We were speaking in particular library grade, grade five, I believe.
Right, because we wanted to have enough clerical and IT assistants down there to be able to flip the desk.
Oh, so you're planning on hiring specific position levels for manning this?
You know, it's really not even that I'm planning to, it's that I want to be able to if we find that we need to. If we find that we're really being hit with a lot of business.
So.
I don't at this time plan to hire it.
So at this time, you're not actually recommending that we hire a particular person or maybe that we create a particular person?
No.
You want to have the money in the budget to possibly recommend it in the future?
Yes, I want to be able to reassure the supervisors that I'm not going to leave them stranded.
Okay. So it's not going to be enough staff for the new digital services area that we are creating?
Because we're pulling people out of the different departments.
Okay.
And so the people from whose departments are having people pulled out are anxious, and then the people that currently work on that desk are just anxious that, you know, the makerspace stuff is, you have to be monitoring it a lot. Since we haven't done it before, we don't know how work intensive it is.
So just because we're saying okay, and we're okaying this supposedly, it doesn't necessarily mean it's all going to be spent right away.
Correct.
Definitely. Well, yeah. Experience from the past has been once we say yes, it's spent. And what we need to do, though, I'm sure there's a need to fill this new media lab. If I'm pronouncing the name incorrectly, I apologize. But should we first figure out if there aren't employees in certain departments that have some free time and maybe who we're pulling and moving?
Oh, absolutely.
It may not be disastrous and we might not need to.
Absolutely.
I don't mind. I mean, I understand when you need to increase positions, but we haven't even done a study to see who's where and what do we actually have.
Right. Well, but that is what you hire me to do, is to take care of the staffing. And all I'm saying is I'd just like to have a little bit more wiggle room because right now it's just at the level that we currently are.
So right now all of our departments are staffed?
Well, we have the digital services supervisor opening right now.
But I mean, in terms of moving people around, we don't possess that flexibility. It's that difficult.
Well, I am going to be moving people around. I'm going to be moving people around a lot, but I just don't want to leave anybody in charge. So I'm not saying for sure that I would need to spend it, but you know, you're saying that we always spend it, but last year we did not spend all of it.
Well, no, what I meant was in the past we come to a board meeting and we would discuss a position and we would agree that if you needed it would happen before we knew it, people were being hired, and we kind of lose the discussion end of it or the fact-finding part of it. So I would like to know that we've already evaluated every department and this is where we stand. This department's like totally overworked and we can't spare a person. I didn't think that was the case.
Well, if you recall, the matrix study that you commissioned did say that IT was very understaffed.
Mm-hmm.
And so
right. Mm-hmm.
We haven't hired that because we aren't quite sure how it's going to shake out with digital services. So
So are you talking IT staff you're hiring?
Well, we're planning on taking some of the IT functions and moving them to digital services.
So you're hiring IT staff?
Yeah, I think that.
Just clerical staff or just regular?
I don't know for sure yet, is what I'm saying. I don't know. They are all on the same pay grade though. The IT technicians and the clerk staff, that's all grade five, so that's where we're asking for that money to go. And that way we have the flexibility.
Okay, right now in the budget for grade five, it's $658,400. Are we using that whole $658,400 for all the grade fives in the library?
Right now?
Or is there?
Well, that was, yeah, that number was purely based on our current.
Salaries, no.
Yeah. And the idea is to stop having people at a higher pay grade do some of the stuff that could be done by people at a lower pay grade. So I'm not asking for somebody higher, this is one of the lower.
Right.
As a result. So, I mean, it is up to you, and it is just to give me a question, and if you aren't comfortable with it, I understand.
We had no idea how popular or unpopular or used or unused this lab is going to be.
If it's a bust, then we're not going to keep this staff.
What do we do if we do not increase this, and 6 months from now or 3 months from now, we find that we are woefully understaffed for this? Can we as a board change the budget, or is it done? Have you gone through this before?
Well, as Linda said earlier, the appropriation is what's actually binding. Okay, the budget is an operating guide.
Okay.
And the appropriation is what we really can't go over without, you know, some machinations after the fact.
So the appropriations at this point would cover it?
The appropriations would cover it, but.
More than.
Yeah, more, no, and I know that.
What we're trying to do is manage responsibly.
Yes.
You know, so that we all are working off the same expectation chart.
Yes.
Here are some initial indicators. We did a 3D printing class, an intro class, last week or the week before. We had something like 44 people show up. I mean, oh my God. We had, what was the other thing? We did the vinyl cutter program prior to that. We had people walking in with projects that were in midstream to get help. It wasn't as well attended, but it was, every seat was taken basically. So we have a pretty strong indication, at least from those two data points, that we're going to get some demand on this. The problem is that a lot of these maker things involve high heat or cutting or, you know, things you just don't really want to, you know, turn over to people and, you know, to your patrons and say, okay, go ahead, because there's risk of injury. And it'll have to be monitored. To what extent it has to be monitored, we're not exactly certain at this point, but we plan to probably fall down the side of over-monitoring it to begin with. And then as time passes, as we get more experience and we all get more comfortable with it, you know, we'll be able to adjust that, so that we're not we just have people watching other people work. It is essential.
Sure.
So, you know, what we don't know is, in spite of the fact that we have these programs that are so well attended and are kind of like our canary in the coal mine, what we don't know is, you know, how this will actually play out after September when we have open labs, and will there be a demand for more open labs, and, you know, and so forth. And you know, that's it in a nutshell.
And kind of to speak to your issue or your comment about the weak staff lines, the media lab essentially is a fairly technical operation.
But right now we're moving them around, so I just wanted to know if moving them is problematic. Something about sick days and vacation days, which is just normal business, you know, the issues that occur. So that's why I brought that up. I don't know that they have to be all, you know, technology majors. But I had one question, but thank you. As far as this year's budget compared to last year's budget, where do we stand? Is our budget for this coming year $6,423,076? Am I looking at it correctly?
Yes.
Okay, and last year's budget was at what? Was it like $5,000,006?
I don't hear those budget numbers.
It says right here, such fiscal year, I think it may have been $5,000,003, but I did see somewhere else it was $5,000,009. So it looks like we've gone up somewhat, but it's not enough to have staff where you need to move them around. And we've already increased.
So the increase in the staff, excuse me, the increase in the budget from last year is a couple of things. One is it's filling some of the spaces, some of the spots that were vacant primarily. So we have a new assistant director, we have a new director of youth services, and a couple of other positions, including 75, including an unhired director of digital services. And I believe that accounts for about $250,000 of growth in the salary line. Materials line, or lines, I guess, the books, the CDs, the other materials that we buy, the e-books that we buy, that's all up about $120,000 over last year. And these are comparisons to actual expenditures, not budget to budget, Carolyn. So just to be clear, these are last year's actual expenditures is being used as a base. And then we also have about $130,000 or $140,000 in additional programming expenses, so that we can, you know, actually demonstrate the labs that we're bringing online and so forth. So in the general fund, those are largely the increases that we're looking at. When we look at the special reserve fund, we had a lot of plans to spend money in the special reserve fund last year, but we ended up only spending about $95,000. And so the monies that we didn't spend last year to refresh our fleet of computers and things of that nature, which could be very expensive, to replace the library's van for deliveries and so forth, which is, you know, getting a little long in the tooth. All of those things added up to about $497,000 this year, compared to a budget of about, or to the actual expense of about $95,000 last year. So there's actually about a $400,000 increase there out of the special reserve.
Right, so we can't, that has nothing to do with general funds. We can't use that. Appropriated for whatever purpose.
But that number that you quoted, that's $6,400,000 at the bottom of the...
which is the grand total for this year's budget.
Yeah, right? That includes the $497,000 of expenses out of the special reserve fund.
So then there's really just about a $700,000 increase.
Yeah, I think it's a little bit more.
Okay. So it's still, you know, close to a million. It's a lot of money.
Yeah, but keep in mind, we have the money in the special reserve fund has been placed in the special reserve fund and has been specifically earmarked for projects that we're pursuing. So
the budget actually includes
the special reserve fund.
The money that's in the special reserve fund.
Yeah, as well as all of our special revenue funds. So the money that we spent for audit is a special revenue fund. Liability insurance is a special revenue fund. All of those funds, when summed together, have about a $315,000 deficit. And, you know, oh my God, it's a deficit. But remember, we're trying to spend down those fund balances and not replace them with taxes.
Absolutely.
until we spend them down, so they can lock up these funds for those purposes.
Right. So has our budget increased from last year?
Yes.
By how much?
I don't have
the comparison. It's not the $700,000, $800,000
we're just talking about. That's a large part of it.
Okay.
Yeah. I can't quote a number.
Oh no, I understand. I'm just going to have two figures. One's over $6 million, one's a little over $5 million. So it's about another $1 million, and I'm just trying to figure out. I mean, there's no indication where in all these line items that occurs But I just want us, you know, I'm not disagreeing that you want to hire people. I'd just like to know, do we go about checking all the departments to make sure we can't move people around? And I don't know, I mean, it's been only a couple of months since we've had that study. I don't know how many changes could have possibly occurred. I just want to make sure that we are responsible about, there isn't anyone else that can handle positions within the library. I mean, there was a time when we said we were interested in job sharing and teaching more than one person how to take care of different departments. And I just was wondering if we can consider that as well before we start out with more hiring.
Yeah, no, I'm a big fan of that. I really, my basic plan is to be, we have a lot of cross-training going on and people working in multiple departments now, and, you know, we want the organization to be as flexible as possible so that people can do more than one job whenever they can. So we've actually increased that tremendously in the last year. We have a number of people that can work with multiple desks and lots of, like, we have our, one of our catalogers comes and sits at the youth services desk, and that helps him with his cataloging, and then it helps them when they leave their hands free to go to a program, and we have a lot of things going on like that now. I definitely do not want to be reckless with staffing because, you know, I can see where that's the ongoing expense. That's where most of our money goes, and, you know, I want to be all sure that it's wise.
And these medium positions are permanent, or do they fluctuate with whatever's happening?
Well, it
is first year. Is now the time to hire? Should we figure out when?
Now is not the time to hire.
But I meant, yeah, how much time before you realize it's an ongoing increase? I mean, you need to hire.
Yeah, I mean, it hasn't started yet. So it starts mid-September, and we'll be pulling people from the departments. I'm interviewing for the supervisor position next week. And so we will be getting that moving within the next month, and then start to get a feel. And many of the people that we're pulling from the departments already work on that desk. But we'll just kind of have to see how it goes. And I certainly wouldn't immediately, I'm not going to panic, is I guess what I'm trying to say. I'm not going to say, oh, it was busy yesterday, I have to hire somebody. Now, it's going to need to be over some time. But, you know, I don't want patrons having to stand and wait. That's not good service. Nobody wants
Which is what we should all want.
Oh, absolutely.
Right. But I'm saying we have an entire library staffed with employees.
Absolutely.
We can always look elsewhere.
We're pretty lean and mean, though.
I think we're kind of lean. However, can I just ask a couple of questions?
Please.
Just to wrap my head around it, maybe it'll help other people too. And I don't know if I can ask, but what is the hourly rate from a library five for coming in? Like, what would they make?
I think that's
time.
The one that starts at 14?
Okay, so let's just say, okay.
Let's just say
you round it to 15. It's, you know, just wondering. So if you're talking about how, and what are the hours that the digital media lab is open?
It's two different studios. One studio is going to be basically the patrons are booking it themselves and they're using it independently. That will be the one where they'll have to learn how to use Adobe Photoshop and Illustrator and things like that. And they'll be working on their own independently. There will be less staff intervention on that one. So, but still some. They'll need help with printing and things like that. Mm-hmm. And learning how to use the equipment initially. And then there's also a green screen in there. Well, they'll be doing recording of video recording, things like that. So there will be some staff intervention on that, but we're not anticipating that one will take a lot. But every time the maker of equipment is being used, that will require staff intervention. So we're trying to set it up so some things, like say the 3D printer, that won't be something where somebody comes in live and does it at the time. They'll be turning something in and staff will be printing it later. So we'll be working with them more on the design end of it, but then the printing end of it, we don't want people manipulating that equipment. And same with the laser cutter. So we'll have open labs, and initially probably just a few times a month. But if it's popular, then obviously we're going to have some demand to expand that. Mm-hmm. So that's the piece I just don't know.
So do you think that you would need, I mean, I wouldn't know how to use any of the items that you just told me. I would not be familiar with any of them. Would you need people to be there, someone there all the time? Would it only be during the after school hours? Is it You know, I mean, how would, yeah.
Well, in terms of the open lab, that would be, you know, just for particular hours. But in terms of the ongoing printing and things like that, it will depend on how much demand there is. And, but they are, that department isn't only managing that equipment, they also were going to be in charge of all of the end user assistance. So what our two IT technicians do now, you know, Greg and Peter, they help you when you have a problem with your tablet. They help somebody when they're having trouble printing. They help a staff member if they're having trouble connecting to something. They do a lot of troubleshooting and making things work. And so that's going to be a big part of the job of this department, is doing, taking on those tasks from IT. And so the, all of the end user kinds of things, both on the staff side and the patron side. And then they also are going to be in charge of staff training, because we really want to raise the overall level of expertise amongst the staff. So that will be a big component of their jobs too. But to do that, they do need the time to be able to be working with people. And we're finding, frankly, with a lot of our older people, they are responding much more to one-on-one kinds of things or two-on-one kinds of things. So we don't, you don't have like a class of 12, 70-year-olds. You work with them more one-to-one. And so there will be some appointment-based programming going on as well. They are, they'll be a department with a lot of responsibility.
The current budget, as it stands right now, allows for the person that we're going to be hiring.
Yes, it does.
So this 150 is for additional staff.
This is if you need it. Yes.
Is that, you know, $150,000 a year, is that three people?
Well, that's how we're trying to figure out the $15.
I think we were thinking it was four people.
It's like four and half the time.
I think we were trying to thinking that we need probably eight FTE down there total. So, but no, we would probably be part-time.
So we've got like four full-time salary, four full-time, but they're...
Yes, but we have the benefits.
Yeah, part-time.
Yeah.
Okay. My question, they're again, I'm new, and I don't know the rules here. If you hire somebody who's part-time, do they get benefits and stuff like the full-time version?
Much more limited.
Okay. Just curious, because that's also an expense.
Absolutely.
Do we need additional information before we decide this? What happens if we don't approve the budget at this meeting? We're approving it at the meeting. Looking to our lawyer.
I believe the statutory limit is the fourth Tuesday in September. So since we, the next meeting would be the third Wednesday, that would come before, I think, the...
Right.
The fourth Tuesday. I'd have to look at the calendar to make sure. You know, looking at the time that would actually hit the calendar for the board meeting, I don't think we'll be any smarter, because I believe the board meeting is just prior to, or just after.
16.
Yeah, it's just prior to the grand opening weekend.
Is there, I mean, we know that it's a new department. We know that there's going to need to be added staff.
Mm-hmm.
150 is just a lot to be kind of thrown in our laps, in my point of view.
Mm-hmm.
That's my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we can come to a compromise and do half, since it's a new department. We don't know what is going to be happening. And if you happen to go over, because you can with the appropriations, we can duly note that, and it will never be held against you. If it's like going off the roof, it will not be held. I mean, but I think to just lay it there and be unsure if it's just going to be, and not that, well, I guess we should put our full trust in you, because that's what we do, and we don't want to micromanage you. However, I don't know, that just...
I like the compromise.
I think
giving more information if you need it.
And then, you know, after we see how the programming goes, and then if you have to, we can discuss it. It'll all be duly noted within our minutes. I don't know. That's just my opinion. If we open up the, please, other board members. Go ahead, Karen.
That sounds like a better idea to me, Linda, but I want a question for Dennis regarding amending a budget. If we pass the budget tonight, can we amend it at our next meeting if we wish to do so? I have a little reluctant to wait till the last minute to pass our budget. You know, yesterday we didn't have a quorum at our next meeting, and we couldn't pass the budget at all. And I guess people, of course, are concerned that we don't already have a budget. So I'd like to at least pass the budget and if need be amended at our next meeting. So that's just how I feel about it.
So I guess then what you're saying, so the budget, we really never had any discussion like prior where we go line by line, do you need this? So am I hearing that this budget's going to stand as is? And we're not?
Go ahead.
No, because we never really discussed our budget.
Well, we did go through, and that's when we got, talked about the salary, when he was going through all the lines and any discussion came up. I brought up that piece.
The salary, that's when he wanted to raise their rates higher.
Right.
And you said, but it can be changed, we'll discuss it.
Right.
But now I'm hearing tonight, we're going to pass this budget, so now there's no discussion.
Well, there is discussion, there's discussion right now.
Right now.
Right.
I brought it up.
Yeah, well, that's what we're having.
No.
Yeah.
I didn't mean to, you know, I meant, our last meeting, we wanted to, Sue said the 2.4 raise is good compared to other libraries. And you says, well, no, I want to do it 3%. And I'm, even after I brought up all the, you know, inflation rate is 1.75, so we're still getting higher than that. I mean, it's for another meeting, and I think I know why the 3% was being given, but I know at the last meeting, when I voted, I said, well, we can discuss this and possibly change it. And everyone, oh, absolutely. Well, my understanding, well, no one brought it up tonight, you want to pass the budget, so what I'm hearing then is their raise of 3% stands.
Well, I don't think we discussed that that would necessarily occur, but that the budget has enough money in it to accommodate that. So that we can still at a later point discuss raises, but the budget has the room for it now.
Well, I think your minutes reflect that you did say the 3%. But I think the thing that was possible was that I had said that I would at some point like to have money where I could reward extra good, extra behavior. That was the piece that we thought maybe could be discussed later. But I believe you did tell us to add the 3%, so we did. That is in there.
That's the way I remember it, right?
That's what I remember also.
I mean, I really would encourage the board to bring up any more questions that you have, because this is, you know, a chance to get more answers, and you can make, you can still make changes now.
Right, and Greg did bring up all the pieces that of the budget that went higher. I mean, the programming and the supplies, the materials, all went up because we were overspending what the budget was because we couldn't make it with what we had last year.
They were cut last year, yeah, those were items.
So I mean, we did talk, you know, kind of pulled out different lines that maybe were more red flags of wonder. How, is that a good way to say it? Is there any other discussion, any other items that you want to discuss on them?
So it sounds like we have,
maybe
we can either approve the budget, we can not approve the budget, or we can approve the budget with 150, or we can approve the budget with a compromise of 150. It seemed like there were three or four.
Yeah, or 75. 75.
Is that
right, we can have on either one. I don't know if you maybe want to go around and maybe we can try to vote on one and just see what people are thinking. Maybe that's the best way we can do it. So I guess that's the only way we'll. Does anybody else have anything else they want to say? Okay. So I want to make sure everyone. All right. So then I'm right.
Right now we have a motion on the floor to approve ordinance number 1505 as it currently stands. There's a motion and it's been seconded.
So do we want to take that back?
Did I make a motion? I can't.
Yes, we can do that. I thought ours had discussed it. We want to take that back, or we want to...
It's up to Carol, you must have to track it.
Well, I would like to amend my motion if the second will accept the amendment. And if not, that's fine, then I'll retract. I'd just like to amend the budget to add $75,000 to the salary line.
To the library grade five budget portion of the, salary?
Yes.
And I'll second that.
Bill, so you accept that amendment? Okay.
I want to second, so...
On the floor right now is a motion to approve ordinance number 1505 with an amendment to the line item library grade five under salaries. The budget number 658412 will be increased by $75,000. But a motion is seconded.
Okay, so any discussion?
I just would like to say that I trust that Mrs. Newell come back to us before any actual plans to hire, and that we want to give you a little room to hire the staff we need. I'm particularly concerned about possible liability if we don't have enough people taking care of the equipment that had been caused some personal injury to our staff members. But before anyone is hired, I really would like to further discussion about this. It's because I'm suggesting that we increase the budget slightly, and then suggesting that we should actually hire someone tomorrow. That's not what I'm suggesting we should do.
Okay, I understand. Okay, all right, take a vote.
Okay, Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Danette?
No.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Is there a motion? Yeses. So I'd like to move the Library Board of Trustees to approve the recommended purchase of a 5 Nokia Minolta copiers and 5 C-pads with one additional release station from Today's Business Solutions for a total of $30,079.70, which is $23,428.70 and $6,651 respectively.
So moved.
Second.
Who's Patty?
Her. Yeah, it was Barb.
Oh, not today?
No. Barb and
Carolyn.
I know, it's like, all right. Okay, any discussion?
I have a question. So a lease option was considered, but the lease would actually cost $8,000 more per year, is that correct?
No, over what the contract, I think it was scaled at 5 years. The difference amounts to financing costs essentially, which their financing costs, that we would pay on this would far exceed anything that we could earn on the money that we get in the bank. So it makes most financial sense just to pay for it all.
Okay. Also, I didn't see that, what is the warranty on that? Or is there was a service plan that was purchased, right?
Yeah.
Yes, there was a warranty. There was a service plan on the copiers, the Continental Delta. It's in the motion as an additional item from Continental Delta. You can see that But the more delivery and stock training network is all part of that. So if there's any problems with the equipment that come out, usually we see them come out the same day, any problem.
And the warranty is, are you saying the warranty is as long as the service contract is? And but the larger story here is that we have, right now, we have a fleet of 13 pieces of equipment. Some are printers, some are copiers. The printers are 9 years old, the copiers are 8 years old. The technology has improved. The yields on toner improved. Replacing toner cartridges, for example, on printers is extraordinarily expensive. We spent $2,400 last year just on printer toner alone. And if we go to all copiers, which the patrons will be able to print to, just like they get print to a printer, mm-hmm. we're charged on a per click rate. So every time there's an image, we would be charged like a fraction of a penny for black and white. And that includes toner replacement and things of that nature. So the net operating expenses, are favorable, for purchasing the new equipment and refreshing, this across the board. It'll clear up any issues that we're having with any of the, other printers or anything like that, and reduce the number of actual pieces of equipment from 13 down to 5, which anytime you can do that and maintain the same service levels, I think is pretty good.
And the 13 pieces of equipment, though, now we're going down to 5, is it going to substantially affect the patrons going and getting the printed material? Obviously, there's fewer
stations. It shouldn't, because if the way that it worked now is if somebody got up to print something, wanted to print something, release it from the station, they would go to one of the printers, one of the 9 printers spread out throughout, throughout the facility. And then if they wanted to reproduce that, then they would go over to a copier. This way, if they want, if they want to print it, they can just go ahead and print it directly in a copier.
What do we do with the old pieces of paper?
Exactly what I was going to ask. Especially now, since they have such a problem where they have old equipment has to be recycled. What do we have to pay somebody to take this? How does this work?
Anything that we get rid of, we don't just throw it to the dumpster or in our, in our dumpster up there.
Sure.
We get rid of, we dispose of it properly, and we take it to an appropriate facility and so forth. But what we would do initially is try to sell it. To try to recoup something. Maybe there's another library who would be just fine, with those pieces of equipment as they are. They'd have to understand that we were selling it, as is with no warranty.
Is that a realistic expectation that we would sell it?
We'd be close to giving it away.
Okay.
We would only get a fraction.
I guess
anything
the bottom
is better
line.
Than nothing. I guess.
Right. Bottom line is it wouldn't cost us to get it.
Yeah. Yeah. No. And what we would do is once they're in place, we'll bring a I don't know if it's a resolution or a motion to the board, to allow us to dispose of those pieces of equipment and get them off premises.
Okay. What is like time frame for this?
Well, like most copier companies are chomping at the bit,
okay.
As you might imagine. So, but I think we implemented in 30 days.
Sure.
Within 30 days, and then we'll come back the next meeting and with a disposal motion.
Okay.
Can you explain the NASCO Valleypoint Cooperative Purchasing Organization? How does that work with respect to
that? So there's an organization out there that that negotiates on behalf of member organizations. We're a member organization, so even though we had no intention at the time, they went out. They negotiated a copier contract. And that copier contract is like a pre-approved purchase. Basically, it's a pre-approved purchase price such that it's not necessary for us to go out and solicit bids for this to be over $20,000. And we would normally solicit bids, but because we're buying this price from this, you know, through this cooperative.
They're essentially done the work.
They've done the work, yeah.
So actually, it saves you a little bit of time and effort.
Exactly. In the past, we bought desktop computers this way. You know, which could be a sizable purchase, but, you know, they've already worked with Dell and HP and all the providers.
Any other discussion? Can we take a roll?
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Devon?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Andy?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Chen?
Yes.
Okay, discussion of new policy 3.30, rules for patron use of the creative studio. It's on page 53. You're wondering where it's at?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And this is not a motion because I thought you guys would like to get a look at it first. Just give me some feedback on it and then I will bring it to you for a motion next month. But I did want to start you thinking about what the rules would be. This is not all of the rules for this. These are the policy-related rules. I don't want to set up a policy that's full of a lot of specific information that then every time we change something, we have to come back to the board. But these are the kind of the basics, such as it is for Niles cardholders only, and the restrictions on the kinds of things that they can do, and that is a board decision that you are, you know, some people would argue that it's a restriction on freedom of speech, but I think that this board has indicated with, you know, putting in filters and things like that, that we consider this to be a conservative community, and so there are some things that we would not consider to be appropriate. That's under point four here.
Mm-hmm.
We're also stipulating that we can help on a basic sort of way, but that we are not going to be making ourselves responsible for fully training anybody start to finish. This is going to be, you know, getting people started, but they are going to have to do some of their own training. We can't possibly, you know, train people individually at an extensive level. And then the last part is important because I actually have already had questions about how will we know if something is copyright, and we're basically saying we are not responsible for determining whether your item is copyrighted or not. You will have to be responsible for that. We certainly will help people find things that are in the public domain if they want. Like one patron has already said that she wants to record herself singing patriotic songs. So we can help her find patriotic songs that might be in the public domain. But we certainly can't say I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy is in the public domain. That we're not going to be the authorities on. She had suggested that we call our lawyer, and we are not going to call our lawyer. So I thought it was important to make
that point.
So if there's anything there that you feel like is missing or off space.
I was wondering if we need to have a patron sign that they've seen these and agree to this? Because just because we have the rules doesn't mean.
Well, I believe that for the some of the equipment, they will have to sign an agreement that they had to understand what the limitations are.
Yeah. And a waiver for the tree. Oh, so, you know, I mean,
that's
right. You know, best intentions, you know, and if they reach over you or something and hurt themselves.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah.
Good.
And then I was wondering about the maker, the printer, the 3D printer. Do we have any thought that maybe we want to limit the use to one item a week or? Two items a week, or what?
We're anticipating that we would be charging patrons for materials, and I didn't put the particular costs in here because they could change.
Sure.
Yeah, we might find a vendor that would give us a better price on something, but yes, we were not planning on the library supplying all of these materials. It would be a cost. Many libraries have done like a cost per gram on the amount of money on the 3D printer. So we would definitely be charging patrons for the materials that they use.
They were talking, I saw an article on the news this week about they were using a 3D printer. And the amount of time it takes for these to print, I would think the energy expenditure would be something too. I mean, other than just the materials.
There may be some that I looked into. Some of that is cost of doing business, I suppose, like the lights and the air conditioning thing.
Well, you can always, yeah, 0.05% then.
Yeah, something.
Material, the count for energy.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, right.
A little bit of wiggle room.
Yes. Yeah, we don't want to make a profit, but.
For the users that are responsible for any lost or damaged equipment, will there be someone going in after that person leaves and check everything?
Definitely.
Will that be part of the process, a part of that other person or possible people that were?
Yes, because people using cameras and things like that will need to make sure that they're, you know, still in good condition.
In the media lab, I'm sorry. In the media lab, does every user need to have a card? Or can it be the person who's doing the project be the card holder? Because I could see somebody coming in with a friend to record something.
Yeah, the two together, they don't both have to have a card.
Okay.
But there has to be a card holder.
Has to be a baseball card. Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
I just have one question. So where this equipment will be, there is staff, or there's staff nearby. Oh, so you'll be able to at least observe who's coming and going.
Sure.
Oh, absolutely. Because I know you mentioned that it's their responsibility to figure out how to work it, but somebody will be in close proximity.
Yeah, it's all locked up, so there would be staff intervention.
Oh, okay, good. Just, yeah.
Then I would assume, so then we can request the sign-up time, or half hour increments or hour increments.
Yeah, I don't think that they have exactly, it's
sure.
Maybe in like a 2-hour blocks for the Studio A recording equipment. The other would be more like on a lab basis where they would save at particular times.
Anybody see anything that might be missing that want to add? Or?
I have some comments that I'll share with Susan.
Okay.
Good. Great.
All right.
So I just wanted to have a first look.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
For Sunday, I would love if the board members could perhaps have a walk through the library to see how all the equipment works that we now own.
Because,
we often talk about it, and I think I know how it works, but I'm really not sure how everything works. And if we're making decisions and relating to policy, it's probably best that we understand all these pieces of equipment as best we can before we go on something like this.
Well, maybe at the 16th we could do a little walkthrough because that'll be ready to launch on the 19th, so it better be ready by then.
Could you do like a board ramp video? That would be really cool.
Sure. If any board member would like to see a copy, or we have one on demo.
They gave us one of the first places.
Okay. Cool.
Do we ever take break?
No.
Just keep going until by the trustees.
Pass on?
Yeah.
Do we have much time?
When do we break after the next move? Move to the Library Board of Trustees approve changes to policy 3.05, which are the lending regulations.
So this one is an actual motion.
Page 55. So I just mover a second.
Go move.
Second for that.
So I did want to get this one on our books. These are our previous lending regulations, and we've added on the line for technology equipment because we're going to be circulating some things now. You've already signed up on the hotspots that's right above it. So these follow a lot of the same parameters. We are loaning things like the GoPro cameras, say, I'll use that as the example. For a one week loaning period, they can put them on reserve. They can renew them if there's nobody else waiting for it one time. Under the restrictions, it says limit of one renewal, and the equipment will be returned to the tech desk. They can't like stick it in the book drop or drop it off at the circulation desk, though, because those are going to be the experts on the equipment that can make sure that it's in good working order and set up and ready to go for the next person. They cannot be taken out on a vacation loan. That doesn't mean that they can't take them on vacation. It means they can't say, I'm going to Japan for 6 weeks. Can I have it for 6 weeks? And that's a no.
And then the part that is a little bit different from other things is that the fine on these is a little bit steeper to encourage people not to sit on the equipment for a long time. Mm-hmm. So $3 a day. And then some of the equipment costs a fair amount of money, $300 say, and some of it costs $15. And I didn't want to break things out into different categories, so I just set it up so that it's a limit, the maximum fine. This is not the replacement cost, this is the fine. The maximum fine would be $30 or the cost of the item, whichever is less.
I think so, it should be whichever is more.
Yes.
The item is...
No, because it's like if you have a strap for the GoPro camera and that costs $15, mm-hmm. I don't want it, them to be charged a fee of $30, a fine of $30, because then they're just going to keep it. They're going to say, okay, I lost it, and they'd rather pay the replacement, the $15 replacement cost, than the $30 fine.
Well, what if just the apps?
Oh, go ahead.
What if you say something like, if an item costs more than $30, it'll be the cost of the item.
Well, you could do that.
So if that's $50 or $100 or $150, then at least we get we're able to purchase a new one.
Well, if they lose it, then they do pay the whole replacement right. cost. Yeah, that's the fine is separate from the replacement cost.
Oh, gotcha.
If they lose something,
$3 a day, limits to $30.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm.
I just didn't want the fine
sure.
to be over
sure.
the replacement
okay.
cost.
Oh, okay. That makes sense. That's like if you lose a
toy, well,
you pay the fine plus then you have the replacement fee.
Correct. Replacement fees is that they pay the cost of it and they okay. pay a processing fee on top of it.
And damage to it when a damage out is in addition is completely separate.
Correct. Okay. This is strictly the lending regulations
all
of
right.
the fine thing. And the maximum.
So when do you decide that a person actually owes the full amount?
It's by
days.
So yeah. So with it, and there will be an equipment list that they will have the items broken out.
What do you mean by that?
$3 a day. So if you have the strap, then you've got 5 days before you hit the limit. But if you
No. I mean, let's say the 10 days is up. I owe $30.
Okay. Right.
When do you tell me that? And I never bring back. Never bring back.
Then
when
we,
do you tell me
then
that
you,
I owe?
Then you go to collection.
When does that happen? That's what.
Well, we don't. We were planning on handling that the same way as other things, but because I think it would be hard to have a single group of equipment. I was talking with
okay.
the head of circulation about it, and it didn't sound like that would be easy to set it up for one particular thing.
Okay.
So right now it would be 2 months is when
okay.
you get the notice saying,
we
have sent you to commit.
Mm-hmm.
And now, and if you do that, you owe. The fine and the fee for the collection.
Sure.
Okay.
And then if we went to no fines, then there would just be a negative $30, but it would be, so even on technology.
Yeah,
see that, that's
yeah.
another
idea.
I'm just throwing it out there. You have a devil's advocate here. Hmm. Okay, so discussion, any more questions? Okay, take a roll.
Karen?
This is for the lending restrictions, yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Betty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Ted?
Yes.
Do we want to take a 5 minute break? Just, we
how
need
much
to do more things.
We had to take a break, but
oh, okay. Take a break.
Right.
5 minute break. Motion to take a break. Aye.
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 Yes.
Aye.
Okay.
Aye.
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 I could say everyone is present that was present in the past. Okay, agenda item number 10, unfinished business. Discuss and possibly take final action on consideration of the adoption of a resolution of the Board of Library Trustees of the Niles Public Library District, Cook County, Illinois, amending the bylaws of the Niles Public Library District. Any discussion?
So moved.
Okay. It's just discussion.
At this point, it's just a discussion. It's 10A.
Yeah.
And 10B would be the actual.
Right, right. Yeah. That's just the discussion. Any discussion?
Just that this would put our bylaws back in the same position they were at the beginning of the year, which they had been before. Mm-hmm. That there would be no particular special treatment of any type of bylaw or any type of provision that are board might take. So it just puts bylaws back to where they had them.
And this would also mean, though, if this, when this passes, IMRF could technically go on the agenda next month, correct?
Well, we could possibly put down that we wanted to talk about a benefits committee of the whole.
Okay, that's, yeah.
Right, yes.
I think what happened when this was created, it was a matter of delaying a vote. And all of us here are looking out for the best interest of the library and the employees. I don't see this coming here, having the IMRF on the agenda and voting, yes, let's pass it.
I'm sure we'll have it.
There's a committee and there'll be a great deal of discussion, so maybe no one, everyone should feel at ease, not alarmed that we would do something like that with such a.
Right, we have such an important decision. Not only are taxpayers very interested in it, our employees have demonstrated in the past that they're very interested in it too, some pros, some cons.
Right.
But it's something that is of obviously great interest to them too. So we would, you know, really want to give everyone a plan, an opportunity to weigh in.
Yes.
If that's even going to be on our agenda yet. I mean, we haven't even decided if we are even going to consider it, so. But that's something that we obviously want to talk about for a long time.
And again, it would be weighing all options. It's, and.
It's not a free decision.
And our staff has changed. We don't have the same staff we had when it was brought up the last time. So again, I think just to be due diligence, I think we'd have to take another staff poll. I mean, just to see what.
I think the biggest concern too is, and for the taxpayers, how much it's going to cost the taxpayers for IMRF. And I think we need other discussion that we, I don't know, we need to look into that before it's brought up, but will the 457B stay intact plus IMRF? That's a question.
I would say we would really go and address every single component because honestly, what we had talked about, what, 2 or 3 years ago, I am sure has changed. I couldn't even tell you everything. I need to be, well, right, we confirmed of everything that even IMRF stands for. Again, what our pension plan is, how our pension is put into our salaries and or, you know, how the choices, all the different things that are happening, we need to, again, have a discussion as a whole. That's why I really didn't even want to have a benefits committee. I really feel this needs to be a benefit discussion as a whole because otherwise the committee's going to have to come back and explain everything to the whole board anyway, so. It just doesn't even make sense because we all need to be 110% informed.
May I have your attention, please?
Yes, we are not jumping on.
15 minutes.
Think fast. Any other discussion?
Yes, to be clear, anybody who's left that's interested in this topic, and at least my position is very similar to Karen's, if this, in the bylaws was discussing the color of the chairs or the paint we use or the light bulbs, it doesn't matter. There's a specific reference in the bylaws and that is not what the bylaws should be. The bylaws should be a general procedure how the library is run. And I felt that this particular item was pushed in a little too stringently and I think it needs to go back to the way the bylaws were originally.
Anyone else? Barb? Yeah? Okay. All right, then, I entertain a motion to adopt the library board of trustees, the resolution, excuse me, let me rephrase. I entertain a motion to adopt the resolution 1502 to remove language from the bylaws.
So moved.
Second. Barb and Carolyn? Any discussion?
I have a quick comment.
Yes.
First of all, for the purposes of the record, the name of the resolution is a resolution of the Board of
Library Trustees of the Niles Public Library District, Cook County, Illinois, amending the bylaws of the Niles Public Library District. The resolution that is going to be passed tonight is going to be just a little bit different than the one that you saw in the board packet earlier. And the difference is simply this. There was a reference in the earlier resolution that the language that's being amended was located at the end of section 11, miscellaneous, and it's not at the end of section 11. So if anybody wants to, here's a copy of current resolution, it simply removes that language as to where it's located in the bylaws.
Just because there's one extra paragraph at the bottom.
Correct.
Okay.
Exactly.
Any further discussion, clarification? Okay, we can take a roll. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Janet?
No.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Motion passes. All right. Agenda item 11, executive session. I entertain a motion to move the library, entertain the library board of trustees go into executive session to discuss the minutes of closed session meetings. Okay, we are going to the executive session at 8:48. Back into the regular session of the Niles Public Library District Board meeting of August 19th, thank you, at 9:23. Okay, who's going to move?
Well, we get one second.
No, we just kind of didn't know.
Take the roll call, Mr. President.
Okay.
Can we convene?
Okay, we convene at 9:23. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Danette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Okay, so the action.
So the chair will entertain a motion to release the closed session minutes of January 15th, 2014, February 12th, 2014, April 16th, 2014, April 24th, 2014, May 21st, 2014, May 29th, 2014, June 18th, 2014, July 15th, 2014, August 20th, 2014, and 11, 19, 2014, and the hold as confidential the closed session minutes of January 30, 2014, February 19, 2014, March 19, 2014.
So moved.
Second?
Yes. Okay. Okay, so who moved? I'm sorry.
So moved in.
So it's Carolyn and
oh, Barb.
Barb.
And Barbara. Okay. Did you all hear me?
Any discussion?
Any discussion? Okay, take a roll. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Danette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Move to adjourn.
So
second.